The defending AUDL champions are just battling to stay alive in the 2017 march to Montreal. It's Jacksonville and Dallas as the 2017 AUDL playoffs begin. We are at the Colony in Texas. This game has been hyped. There's been a lot discussed about whether this game could be chippy. These are two teams that certainly have a lot of confidence and swagger. Second game of the year for Kurt Gibson. His first at home after he needed surgery for a pectoral injury suffered before the season. Roughnecks take their time and a rifle from Gibson to Coffin to make it 1-0.
So many just high caliber throwers on the line. But this wind is very gusty, and it's a crosswind. They were able to keep them on the downwind side of the field the entire possession. I think when you're representing the U.S., you should have to at least get some buy-in from your members for everybody going with bleach tips at Worlds.
Mazur shoots it. Freechild in the end zone, and he's got it. The Roughnecks break. Freechild is playing in front of his mother, who surprised him at the airport last night. They got off the plane, his mother was there, and Dylan was so happy to see her. The first thing he said was, "What are you doing here?" Chris Larberg, marked by Michael Fairley, back to Bennett. Drove 4.5 hours from Houston to get here today, and that disc intended for Froude, cleaned up by Dylan Larberg. Wow. Dylan looked off his brother Chris and found Dalton Smith. Dallas really making every throw difficult right now. Frey Stotter has nowhere to go downfield. Even the reset was hard on the sidelines. And with a stall count rising, Perales forced to jack it. It's nice to have a 6'8" target. Frey Stotter got hammered. That has to be a foul.
You'd think, right?
Jacksonville punches it in, thankfully.
Yeah, such a sad story about Bobby Lay as well. I mean, you look at him on that point and compare that to the last game when they're here. I mean, man, when he had the disc, if you're rooting for Jacksonville, you just got to be real happy with him having the dip.
Chris Gibson marking Kurt Gibson.
Bizarre.
And Kurt Gibson's throw just out of the reach of Slack.
And I mean, that was such a difficult throw to even attempt, but he's been getting the I.O. so consistently that he takes the shot.
Jakeem Paul quickly back to Travaglini for Frey Stotter. He's got it! Just shy of the goal line, Laurie gets the mark on, and Frey Stotter finds Gibson. It's Chris Gibson who has the goal for the Cannons.
You know, knows that the wind's kicking right to left here, so the shot goes up. This is going to keep diving to the left. Frey Stotter holds his position and says, you know, if it gets a little too high, I'll sacrifice the body to make the play, and he does just that with the left hand in the wind. What a start.
Laurie couldn't handle that pass on the sideline. Plenty of time for Sullivan, who will launch the floating backhand. Jakeem Polk in a battle with Freechild. And holy cow. A huge mistake in the back of the end zone. Jackson had a tumultuous year, broke several bones in his arm, in his throwing arm, his right arm.
His recovery's been pretty impressive.
Well, he played through it, being a shell of himself, and he's just getting back to his old self. There's Freechild in the end zone for Dallas to make it 4-2. Yields Chris Larberg, resets for Smith. Dangerous blade to the back of the end zone. It did not work.
On the catch, I believe.
Yeah, you're right.
They look so similar. I do that all the time.
Stanley Peterson, this one he'll come down with in the end zone. Married, just rejoined the team after he wasn't on the roster for most of the season. He's got 2 assists in the first quarter.
It's pretty nice when you got guys like Jay Froude and Larberg who are so fat.
Florida. We hear that he is en route right now. Roney sends it to Sullivan. And one more flip into the end zone to Fairley. 5-3, Cannons back within two. More than 2 minutes off the clock. On the second effort, Huston will keep it alive. Had to go out of the end zone to do it, but he will overshoot Cole Sullivan. And
so certainly if you get in his head, if you get a matchup that's a little advantageous, he's a guy that can be beat.
That was certainly one of my biggest takeaways from the World Games, and more so from watching the USA team practice as the Cannons with a clean 0 point.
Yeah, when I first started watching Dylan Freechild, it was when he was in college at Oregon.
Yep.
And one of the memories that's really imprinted in my mind was
Pittsburgh also had Alex and Max Thorne and Pat Earls and Marcus Rainey Dropcho, and you could go on.
It's true.
Trent Dillon.
Well, it makes you wonder. I mean, that's a really great point. It makes you wonder, is Jordan Huston as good as his stats say he is, or is he just playing with one of the greatest setup guys in the league?
Gibson looking for Freechild. He's got him. He beats Kerner deep. And Freechild finds Coffin for the goal. To have every player in College Ultimate know who you are and still have two more full years. Guys usually gain hype late in their careers. It's different for what Dylan's had to deal with, obviously.
Sure. Threatening the help deep and just playing that even D underneath, making him come under and collect his unders. I mean, he's a guy, I would think you'd want him to have the disc under, speaking of which.
Out of the reach of Langdon here in this playoff game in Dallas. And Jay Frood makes sure Huston still won't find the end zone. What a bid from Frood. Just an incredible regular season for Frood, making plays like this near the goal line.
Yeah, just such great athleticism, great hunger for the disc.
Oh, Polk nearly had the under on Laurie, but now it's Mikkel marked by Freistadter. And Mikkel launches long. Thomas Slack using his speed to break away. Resets for Jackson. Mikkel to Coffin for the goal.
He's like that Mario character. He does everything great. Just a guy you can count on. So good with the disc, incredible size. It's really hard to pick out, when we're talking about defenses, is choosing what you're going to let the guy do, right? I mean, I don't know what to tell you about Jimmy. You're kind of in trouble regardless. And I really think, if I'm one of the coaches on Jacksonville, I'm telling these guys, you cannot throw outside and backhands down this sideline again. That's the third one in a row that didn't work.
Kai Marshall's taking off. Marshall in the end zone for the Roughnecks.
The wind is blowing away from your monitor. So when you throw this backhand hook, it's going to come down pretty true. It's going to come down quick. It's going to stay flat. If anything, it's going to turn over a little and drop even quicker.
Dallas has certainly turned up the intensity defensively. Sullivan wants Langdon. And Langdon again mistimed his jump. And one referee has ruled pass interference, and Langdon says no. Yeah, Langdon, I don't think, wanted a foul there. I think he was concerned about landing on Chris Larberg.
Yeah, not Langdon's best stuff here. You can see the little bit of a collision, a little bit of a mistimed play.
These guys were teammates a year ago at this time.
I do not know how far you can go with that integrity rule.
Oh, Freechild tried to sneak it through to Frood. And
back injury is so difficult in Ultimate. I mean, name a movement where you're not using your back.
How about that acrobatic crab walk from Dylan Larberg to try to get a hand block? There's Freistadter in the end zone for the Cannons, using every inch of his 6'8" frame.
And I'm seeing Bobby Lay step onto the field. Do my eyes deceive me? So Bobby made it. Hopefully he's in the right headspace to play. But look at this great catch from Misha. He uses his size so well, and he never takes his eye off the disc.
And there is Bobby Lay, the young man out of the University of Florida, who again missed the first 15 points of this game, more or less, because he had to attend the funeral of a close family friend earlier today. Sullivan rips it.
And if you're on the field, you might as well run after this.
Langdon trying to adjust, and tremendous defense there. You know, Dallas overcame a 7-goal lead the last time these two teams met.
Well, from what I know about Dallas,
Freistadter lingering deep on Kai Marshall, who's had several big catches late in quarters in his two seasons with Dallas.
I love Kurt Gibson, by the way. I feel like he's always frustrated with everybody downfield, no matter what's happening.
Freechild was hit from behind.
Ooh.
And with a tenth of a second on the clock, but there's no foul, I don't believe. I think they called a timeout for Jacksonville. Dallas has the numbers. Jacksonville has the numbers.
Man, that upwind corner is looking pretty good.
Hammer looking for Freistadter near the front pylon. He's got it!
Oh, my goodness. Look, you're double team. You got a double team, and you're leaving Freistadter with a step to the open side, the downwind side. I'm just going to call it the open side because that's what it is in a win like this.
This is the first of 11 AUDL playoff games that we'll have over the next month leading up to championship weekend in Montreal.
This is prime time. This is the best ultimate being played.
Jacksonville with four losses this year, all to the number one team. Mikkel shoots it for Gibson, and Kurt has his first goal of the day. Took just 34 seconds for Gibson to go downfield and Mikkel to find him.
And watch the touch here from Mikkel. So the wind's kicking hard to the left on the screen right now, so he throws it really, really high, really, really high and outside in. That was interesting. Couldn't see.
Oh, and Gibson with a left hand over the shoulder to Mikkel.
I think Gibson's just getting motivated right now.
Certainly some chirping after the contact. And that's pretty impossible to stop right there.
Yeah, nice throw. Kurt, always unhappy. Always playing with that general kind of, what the heck? Who's got the record? Misha had it a couple years ago, right? But that, I believe that got broken. Wow.
I believe it is Misha.
Is it still Misha? Okay. One guy that responds relatively well to that is Kurt Gibson, but I think in general, as far as a team, wow.
Froude got a piece of that, Katrin.
And that's what I'm talking about. Bobby Lay, so confident.
Lay slicing it through the wind, and finally Langdon has the goal.
If he might be even more critical to the success of Jacksonville than we initially suspected.
And Lay lets it fly. Langdon plays through the whistle. There was a pick called. Langdon, pretty impressive hammer. This is Roney shooting it for Huston. Peterson playing catch up. And Peterson comes up with a D. Oh, that's a tough throw. Peterson runs it down. He's a step away from the end zone. Freechild. Waiting for a cutter. Swings it. Peterson around and into the end zone.
Because if Jacksonville is going to win, they have to come back big. And the kind of game they play their best in is an adversarial game, a fiery D from Stanley Peterson there. And this throw is bananas, by the way. What a difficult shot.
Yeah, it's been a stiff breeze blowing basically across the field all night long. Lay lets it rip. Huston trailed by Larberg and Froude. Huston had it ripped away by Froude. Holy cow. Dallas looking to stretch the lead to 8.
Freechild with steps.
Froude sends it. Freechild breaking away from Huston. And Dallas breaking away from Jacksonville.
and then he's bouncing all over the place. He's flipping over signs. He's got just energy to burn.
Here's the D from Frood. Unreal.
Look at that.
And remember earlier in the game, Free Child and Frood had the miscommunication around the goal line. This certainly makes amends.
Clutton is just taking Langdon out of the game, more or less. I mean, Langdon was the difference maker towards the end of the last game.
Bobby Lay with 4 seconds. Freistadter with 2. And Roney at the buzzer scores for Jacksonville. Don't have a lot of time to dilly-dally here.
That's true. Walking to the center as the clock ticks down may not be in your best interest.
Oh, goodness. Langdon can't believe what he just did.
Langdon having a terrible game.
To Bennett. Matt Bennett launching. Frood versus Katrin. Jay Frood does it again.
I mean, you kind of don't realize how fast Jay Frood is. This disc goes up. It's essentially a throw to a matchup. He's got steps, but with this wind, you can't really make a precise throw. But he says, I'll take Frood, even against a gigantic defender like Katrin.
Two-time AUDL champion, Gibson won in 2014 with the San Jose Spiders. Here's Jimmy Mickle launching. Ben Laurie floating to the end zone, but Freistadter makes up the distance, and then he's called for the foul, and then the integrity rule will overturn it.
That's the right call, yeah. I guess I missed it. Looked like two guys went for the disc.
Looking deep the other way, Polk trying to go over Jackson. And Matt Jackson comes up with a plastic first. From this Jacksonville D-line offense. And finally, Freistadter comes free.
He showed some really incredible speed. I mean, you think about it, this guy's 6'8". And that was a good throw that didn't actually float that long. And Freistadter runs it all the way down.
Free Child over to Gibson. College teammate Dustin Travaglini on the mark.
That's an upwind scooper, folks.
And now Mickle slicing the flick to the end zone for Free Child. Those are the Bleach Boys.
Kurt Gibson throwing the scooper over the top upwind like it's nothing. Dylan Free Child getting open. So here's the double team. Gibson, that's upwind. Makes it look so easy. To Jimmy Mickle, Free Child's open, and Mickle just throws a blade across the whole stack like it's nothing.
Under 6.5 minutes to go. Jacksonville trailing by a touchdown. Roney at midfield, lets it fly.
I like it.
Fairley is there.
That's the one thing he's got as a real differentiator is the over-the-top stuff that doesn't require a foot race. I mean, you're giving him this goal. I don't understand that.
When that disc was released, it didn't look like Laurie had a chance. It
looked like a throwaway, yeah.
Mickle looking Coffin's way. Another dime from Jimmy Mickle.
This is a crazy throw. Watch his feet. Hardly even set. He's kind of up on his toes. And just drops this in here. I mean, there's a lot of wind right now. Dylan Freechild trying to lock down Bobby Lay. I mean, they really want him to have the disc, and it's been difficult.
Lay lets a backhand go. Fairly, does he have the legs? Not like Dan Emmons, or Kai Marshall, beg your pardon. That's Emmons looking for the assist, and he's got his man. The lead back to 8 as Peterson gets open for the Roughnecks break. Jacksonville has just over 3 minutes with which to work. Oh, goodness! Matt Bennett soaring over Bobby Lay, and that might be the knockout blow.
You can see just a loose swing pass here. Sits up, and that's all Matt Bennett needed to see.
Chris said okay.
Sounds reasonable.
Chris joined the Roughnecks midway through last season after moving from New York to Dallas. He's just moved to L.A., though, as Lay shoots it long. Sullivan makes the catch.
just start running as far away as you can.
Break side.
Break side, because you know Bobby's going to get it. He doesn't need a whole lot of time to get that backhand off.
And Sullivan dishes it for Roney. Final throw of the game. Good if it goes. And Langdon could not hang on in the end zone. And the Dallas Roughnecks are headed back to the South Division title game with a convincing 22-12 victory over the Jacksonville Cannons.